It's time to go back in history and do a good read that'll suit you on a long winter's evening. Thomas Hardy's Far From the Madding Crowd. Here it is, and we're going to drink Yorkshire tea. He actually published this as a book in 1874, so he couldn't have had that because it didn't come about until 1886, but it was the general time period there. And this has lovely pictures
suitable
of sheep. 19th century people really enjoyed the whole idea of shepherding, and they thought it was pastoral and peaceful. I picked this book up at a stressful time in my life. I saw the pictures on there. I thought, oh, doesn't that look peaceful? And it's called Far From the Madding Crowd, based on a poem that Hardy read and liked. If you're familiar with 19th century writing, it's a little bit flowery.
A little bit. I could feel the roses coming out of my ears.
It didn't suit Emma at all. What'd you read? Three pages?
Three pages. Didn't like it. Watched the movie. Definitely didn't like it.
Give you a sample here. Oof. Is it Sergeant Troy? Said the blurred spot in the snow, tremulously. This person was so much like a mere shade upon the earth, and the other speaker so much a part of the building, that one would have said the wall was holding a conversation with the snow. Yes, came suspiciously from the shadow. What girl are you? Oh, Frank, don't you know me? Said the spot. Your wife, Fanny Robin. Fanny, said the wall in utter astonishment. Yes, said the girl with a half-suppressed gasp of emotion. Okay.
I don't like Sergeant Troy.
No. So we meet these characters. First, we meet a man named Gabriel Oak, who is a farmer, and he farms sheep. He's got his land leased, and he has these two dogs who help him shepherd the sheep. The problem is, one of the dogs is really stupid.
Mm-hmm. Like if we took Chester and removed his brain and made him less cute.
Yes, our Great Pyrenees actually was designed for taking care of livestock.
Although sometimes he tries to eat them.
But sometimes Chester does want to play a little more than the goats would like. And this dog in the story, young George, also wants to play. Gabriel meets a girl who is just moving into the area to live with her aunt. She's an orphan. She's very beautiful, and her name is Bathsheba. Although in the movie they pronounce it Bathsheba. And this girl, I've got to say, is a twit.
Apparently she's better in the movie, but
yeah,
none of them are all that good.
In the movie, she actually seems to be more of a steel magnolia, but in the book, she's just a twit. And in the movie, you do see a lot of bad decisions that she makes.
Oh, so many bad decisions.
Mainly around men. She has three men who would like to marry her.
None of them are all that nice.
Well, Gabriel Oak is lovely.
He's
a shepherd. He is a solid man, faithful to the end of the book.
Troy is terrible.
Just delightful. Then we have Farmer Boldwood. In the first few chapters, Bathsheba moves up in the world, and Gabriel has a reversal of fortune due to his stupid dog.
And bye
so,
bye sheep.
Bye bye sheep. So Gabriel actually ends up as an employee of Bathsheba after she has already rejected his offer of marriage. So Farmer Boldwood is a man who does not notice women, really just goes about his business being a farmer until Bathsheba provokes a response, because she can't stand that there's a man in the universe who doesn't admire her beauty. So she sends him a valentine.
Lovely, lovely lady.
And then he falls in love with her, and now she doesn't want to marry him, but she feels bad about it because it's her fault that he came out of his little hole to notice that she existed. But Bathsheba really wants this goober named Sergeant Troy.
I don't know why.
The same goober who was at the window a while ago with the snowflake talking. Sergeant Troy is handsome and dashing and a complete cad, and you can tell from the very opening sequences as soon as he enters that he's a complete cad, but for some reason the little twit likes him. So we spend the rest of the book going through all the lovely 19th century machinations that you have.
And terrible 19th century decisions that they have.
Now, this is set somewhere in the 19th century when the gravestone appears late in the book. It just says 18-something because that's how they used to do back then. They would just not assign a date and let you imagine. but it feels like it's before
the Industrial Revolution.
The Industrial Revolution. It's argued about when it was, but it generally is 1760 to about 1840. So I'm thinking that it happened a little bit before his time, because he writes about it in past tense and gives a lot of details about the customs as if they're not going to be familiar to the reader. This was originally published as a series of installments in a magazine, Cornhill Magazine, and then later put into a book because people liked it so much. Thomas Hardy wrote several other books, and we'll link some of those down for you, as well as this book and the movie attached to it. The movie we watched is the more modern one. There's actually
that one was 3 hours long.
There's actually several. We watched the previews, and this is the one that we thought we would like best. The one in 1967 was probably the most historically accurate, going by the previews, but Emma just did not like it.
I didn't like any of them.
So in the 19th century, of course, you have to put lots of exciting details in it. So you have somebody who drowns and somebody who runs away and somebody who joins the circus, although you don't see that part in the movie.
Oh, yeah, I was about to say, I don't remember the circus.
Yeah, that
part. I think you told me about, like, an entire part of the circus that wasn't mentioned.
Oh, like, well, there's always in the movie there's less because you don't want a movie that's too long. You know, she dithers about which ones to marry and they're all pitiful and reclining upon each other's bosoms and all that stuff that people do.
Here's a good one. This seemed feasible enough, for Turpin's speeches were not many or long, the fascination of the piece lying entirely in the action, and accordingly the play began, and at the appointed time, Black Bess leapt into the grassy circle amid the plaudits of the spectators. That's one. Two, at the turnpike scene, where Bess and Turpin are hotly pursued at midnight by the officers, and the half-awake gatekeeper in his tasseled nightcap denies that any horseman has passed, Coggan uttered a broad-chested well done which could be heard all over the fair above the bleating, and Poorgrass smiled delightedly with a sense of dramatic contrast between our hero, who coolly leaps the gate, and halting justice in the form of his enemies, who must needs pull up cumbersomely and wait not to be let through.
That's two sentences there.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have those scrolling by so you can enjoy the wordiness of it. So if you like wordiness,
lovely.
If you were an English major in college, you have to read this book. If you like Jane Austen, you need to read this book. I think Emma will never read Jane Austen now.
There's a lady at our church who loves Jane Austen, and whenever she sees me, she says she thinks of Jane Austen because of the book Emma. And I'm not sure how to feel about that.
Oh, the Emma in the book is a twit.
Aren't they all?
I think all 19th century novel characters are, in fact, twits.
Lovely.
Having said that, I enjoyed Far From the Madding Crowd, and I read it about once a decade. You know, usually when life is overwhelming and I want to go to a time when nobody had a computer or a car.
Or sanity.
Or any memory of the Industrial Revolution. And I get a little peace.
Until I come into the room and bother her again.
And then they get all crazy and I'm glad I don't know them. And I come back to the 21st century and I'm happy again.
Because we realize the grass is not always greener on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when it comes to literally anyone in the 19th century, apparently.
So I'm grateful to be living in a time where I am, I think.
Who knows?
So try this book and let me know in the comments which books you particularly enjoyed from the 19th century. And until we see you again,
make sure to make Tavertine a good book.